Ivan Sayers is a committed and delightful costume and fashion historian who studies and collects women's, men's, and children's fashions from 1600s to the present time. Once a month or so, we ask him to dig through his comprehensive collection of historic clothing, hats, gloves, purses, and shoes, and baubles to bring us a few fine pieces. Today, he has a titch of royal fever and is in a wedding mood. It is my pleasure to welcome Ivan Sayers back to Studio 4 to tell us more.
Thank you.
Nice to see you again.
Thank you. Thank you. It's nice to be here.
So you're thinking about weddings, are you, and royalty and people like that?
Well, I think it's in the air. Everyone is. Even the negative ones, they're still sort of fascinated and they just love to complain.
So. Right. They're not going to watch.
No, of course not. They won't be getting up at 1:30 in the morning or whatever
right.
it is.
No, but they'll watch.
They will, of course.
Yes,
they will.
Of course they will.
Yeah.
So have you done a wedding show before?
Over the years, we've been doing shows for 40 years, so
right.
yes, we have done them, usually in June or in association with one of the big wedding fairs or something or other, but it seemed appropriate to use that theme right now since it is topical.
And what's changed over the years, wedding dress-wise? You don't have to take me back to 1650.
No, no, I'm not going to.
But say 100 years ago, 200 years ago, more lace then?
Well, now it's more provocative, I guess. I mean, I'm getting old myself, so and I am a traditionalist. I like history. So what the aspect of modern wedding clothes that I don't like is that they're either strapless or spaghetti straps.
Mm-hmm.
When I was a kid, the bride was supposed to be modest. She was supposed to be covered up, and admittedly, she was covered with lace, so it was transparent. Mm-hmm. But the sleeves of her garment were long, and it had a high neckline. And oftentimes the bolero would be removed for the reception, so she would have an evening dress for an evening function.
Right.
But at the service itself, regardless of what religious group it was, she was covered up from the chin down.
Well, not anymore, dear.
No.
No. Strapless and tatas and all of that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But it is, presumably, it is her day. She should wear what
right.
she wants to.
In fact, some bridesmaids today can wear black. Really, whatever color they want.
Yes, I went to a wedding in my own family, and the bride wore a white dress, but all the attendants wore black dresses with white accessories.
Sure. Well, I think of royal weddings, of course, Queen Elizabeth II and Philip.
Yes.
Very traditional.
Wonderful. I find those clothes of the late 40s a bit sort of busy and heavy often. But that dress, I think the fabric was remarkable because it was damask woven, and there were motifs representing all the countries of the United Kingdom, as well as all the countries within the Commonwealth. So there were Canadian images, Australian images, Indian images, and so on and so forth. And so it was well thought out. Apparently, there were four lengths of the fabric given to four different brides in Canada. And there is supposed to be some woman here in the Lower Mainland that has one of the dresses made out of her own wedding dress, but made out of the same fabric that
really?
The Queen's was made from.
How great. And who dressed the Queen?
Well,
mostly.
The most important designer is Sir Norman Hartnell. But Hardy Amies did the suits, I think, a lot of times. And there were various milliners that worked for the royal family. But you know, the royal family is actually quite clever, and they know enough to try to spread out their business throughout the better designers so that everyone gets endorsement, and it helps the economy.
Well, Hardy Amies, great designer.
Absolutely.
Yes. He wrote a book a long time ago. I don't know if it's still in print. It was called The ABC of Men's Fashion. Hardy's ABCs of Men's Fashion, something like that.
I don't
and he
know
always
the book,
said,
so.
Men can wear red.
Oh, yes.
Men can wear red, spend money on a belt, and avoid sandals and shorts.
It's all
don't
in the details.
Make everything match.
Yeah.
Now, our lovely brides, are we seeing all brides today or some
no,
brides and some others?
We're going to do a little bit of a variety because the show that we're doing this coming weekend will be varied.
Okay.
So it'll be wedding dresses, bridesmaids' dresses, the notorious bridesmaids' dresses, mother of the bride, mother of the groom, something for going away. So, and conceivably some lingerie as well, because the trousseau is an important aspect.
It's true. You know? In my day, they were really bad. Like you, we're wearing our flannels usually at home.
Exactly.
And now you're supposed to emerge in front of the groom in this outfit.
Over the years, I've had several women give me their trousseau negligee and never worn.
No.
Well, I think probably the first night they didn't want to, and after that they just thought, this is not me. I'm not the fluffy, frilly, transparent nylon chiffon type.
No, well, because you had a little nightie, and then you had a thing that went over the little nightie, so you're like in your see-through coat.
Yeah, it's all about packaging.
It was Saturday Night Live, pretty much. And here is Cindy looking lovely. Beautiful.
Cindy's fabulous. Wearing a dress from about 1911. This would be appropriate for a wedding outfit, or for that matter, without the bouquet, for a very important member of the wedding family. Mm. This is Battenberg lace, so this is all put together by hand. It's machine-made tapes, and then they're sewn down to a pattern, and then all stitched together by hand. The coat actually belonged to the family that owned the Hollies on the Crescent in Shaughnessy.
Oh.
And this was presumably the mother's, one of her accessories at her wedding. Mm. The daughter wore it as a dress during the Second World War, when restrictions were an issue, when you couldn't get a lot of raw materials. So she actually sewed the front of the coat up, had a short white slip underneath it, put shoulder pads in it to comply with the rules and regulations of wartime 40s look, and made a very successful dress out of it. It was a Mrs. Mowat that gave it to me, and it was her mother's
so
and her own wedding
So you had to be innovative
dress.
During wartime, as always, the hat.
The hats are enormous, and just before the First World War, the hats of this size are popular from about 1909 through to 1912, and they are the major punctuation. They're gorgeous.
I'm sure. So is that lace terribly expensive? Could you even get it today?
You can, actually. It's still being made in China, of course, now, because you get the skill and you still get the low price.
Right.
Usually in little parasols. There are several shops in town that are selling it. And, in fact, I have a dress that's probably 5 or 6 years old that's made out of silk Battenberg, and in colors. They don't do it in white very often anymore, but it's in satin piping that they stitch all together by hand.
Yes.
And considering how much work goes into it, it's remarkably inexpensive.
Remarkably.
Still beautiful. Things don't have to necessarily be old to be beautiful.
No. But some old things are beautiful.
And some old things are really horrible. Well, we're exceptional, of course. But
of course. Thank you, Cindy. That was lovely. And Mary Lou, always welcome in Studio 4. And she is wearing...
She's wearing a white, an ivory wool dress with wool chemical lace in this instance. That was worn by the mother of the bride in Winnipeg in 1924. The dress was made by a Madame Desjardins in St. Boniface, which is the town right across the river from Winnipeg.
Right.
The bride was a Mrs. Patterson. I bought this from her in the West End 25, 30 years ago, I suppose. And unfortunately, I never got her mother's name, because then I'd have the name of the woman who actually wore it. But this is early 20s. This is the exact opposite in terms of displaying the figure. The dress that Cindy just had on, it is about showing the figure. This is the 20s, and they're emancipated women. They want to be seen as intelligent creatures, not as ornamental objects. Oh, you want to be ornamental as well.
Sure.
So the dress is loose, hangs from the shoulders. So you can flap.
And Charleston.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. First time in living memory that they didn't need to wear girdles or corsets if they didn't want to.
Really?
Yeah. They thought this was brilliant, because the dress actually hung from the shoulders.
How great. Don't tie me in. And the beautiful pearls and gloves. I noticed Cindy had gloves and Mary Lou has gloves. So they all, are they leather or?
These are kid leather. Oftentimes at a wedding, because it was formal, the bride was expected to wear gloves, but then there would be that horrible awkwardness as she took the glove off to put the ring on. So occasionally you'll find a pair of gloves that went with a wedding outfit and the ring finger has been cut off.
Really?
Off the glove, that is not the bride.
No.
So that she could slip the glove, the ring right on without removing the gloves.
That makes sense to me, thank you.
It's all about orchestration.
Lovely. And yet another hat.
Another hat, oversized. This is the early 20s, and they're trying to make everything look too big so that she looks smaller and more sort of vulnerable. That's the provocative aspect.
A great
it's
fashion
not about
trick.
Display. It's about looking vulnerable so that the man gets to feel protective.
Exactly.
Psychology.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Psychology of fashion.
Yeah.
And let's welcome Virginia because she is going away, taking us away. Wedding over. This is the going away suit.
This is the going away suit.
Oh my.
From Mrs. Jim Robinson. I should have brought my note, but I've got a hold of the people last night. And this is by Hardy Amies. In 1949, this was bought at the French Room at Eaton's.
I worked at Eaton's when they had
you?
A French Room.
Well, the best quality. And they really did sell French imports as well as top of the line, obviously, British imports and so on. Fabulous suit. This is really good example of new look. And I like garments that have eccentricities or design features. And Virginia, if we can see the back again in the skirt, half the back
pleats.
Is pleated and half is plain. So when you move, that pleated part will flare out and it catches the eye. Great, clever
design. It's a beautiful suit.
Touch.
You could wear that suit today.
Absolutely.
The bag is excellent.
It's the Kelly bag.
Kelly bag.
No, it's not the real
Hermes.
One. The real Hermes ones are a bit pricey.
Thousands of dollars.
But
what, $4,000 or six?
And,
I don't
and they
know.
Go up to 24.
Really?
Depending on what they're made from and so on and so forth. This is actually a Spanish knockoff, but it is from the 50s.
Right.
This I got from the estate of Winifred Bracher just this last winter. Mm-hmm. Winifred was the head of the home economics department at UBC.
Oh, really?
And very small but very smart woman.
Yes,
she
very
loved
much.
Textiles.
And the hat. That
the hat
is
came
one
out of the Salvation
hat.
Army. Isn't that the most wonderful
yes.
hat?
I love it's a
that.
Wonderful hat.
And within my collection, that's called the Up and Down hat. That's
of
its,
course
that's
it is.
Its code name.
I thank you. Thank you, Virginia. And a few goodies here. We're running out of time, but I want to see this doll. What is that?
Well, this came to me from a fellow named Jim Erickson. He's in movie props and sets and costume and whatnot. He lives on Salt Spring. And he passed on to me some Edwardian clothing this a couple of years ago now. And this was in there. And as far as I know, it's a gift for a bridal shower. So it's a bride. She has her veil on and so on and so forth. Her face, which is a bit macabre here, is actually painted on the bowl of a wooden spoon. Her wig is a dish mop. Her arms are clothes pegs, and of course this is very sort of gender specific here. Mm-hmm. The bride is going to be a housekeeper for the rest of her life here, you know, the cliche of the time. Mm-hmm. But it is, I think it's great. It's so peculiar. It looks a bit like a voodoo doll, but it's meant to be positive, of course.
It's great, as you are. And you will be having an event. Here Comes the Bride event, Sunday at 2 p.m. at McCrae Avenue, Highcroft.
Yes, at the Highcroft
House, McCrae Avenue.
That's right.
I thank you. Always a pleasure.
Thank you. Thanks for having us all.
Ivan Sears.